Hi, welcome back. So I've now got all the parts disassembled in the garage, and I brought in my X gantry plate, which is of course these two pieces here make up the X gantry moving part, and I've got the Z axis of course here with the motor mount on the front. Now one of the things we're going to do is we're going to upgrade the motor mount to the new one that I've designed on the 3D printer that still goes on this 6020 extrusion. We're going to replace these two plates with the slightly different designed Rover plates, and we're going to have four wheels now holding the Z axis instead of these three wheels as well. And any other things that come up as we're going through the assembly, I will point out on the video. So let's get to the bench and we'll start assembling the Z axis parts first and the Z axis gantry parts. So that you can see how we do that, and then we'll start taking parts off of this one as we need to move them across onto the other ones, and I'll highlight some things you need to watch out for on the way. So what we're looking at here is the front plate, the new Rover, I have a habit of calling them Red Rover for obvious reasons, but the new Rover front X-axis gantry plate, which has the new spaces which are drilled for four sets of wheels on the front. I've only mounted three sets of wheels on each side right now because I wanted to show you mounting the last one and any particular things you need to pay attention to while we're doing this. As you can see here, the one on the left has the bigger hole for the eccentric nuts to go in, eccentric spaces to go in, and on the right hand side it's just a regular M5 clearance for a regular spacer to go on top of that. Now when you're building this, the wheels I've got here are these nice pretty red ones from SMB Solutions. They've got a color matched bearings and things like that, which is kind of really nice. Aside from that, they're the fairly standard extreme V wheels that you see in the open build solution. And what you need to make up these parts, of course, is there's my last two wheels. On one side, I'm going to use the eccentric spacer, and as you can see quite clearly here what one looks like, you've got a hole in that is offset, and then you've got a flange which goes into that standard hole on the spacers. So as it rotates, it will change the position of the screw in relation to the rest of the mounting bracket, which will either take it tighter onto the extrusion or looser as you move it to the outside. And this is how you adjust the tension of the wheels. Anyway, so you're going to need an eccentric spacer, you're going to need a regular spacer. Now, one of the things that you also have to have on these are precision shims. Now, I've already shown you in the past how to assemble the wheels, and basically they come in kit form. I'm just going to show you some here so you can see them. Now, the difference between these and the red ones I've got is purely the fact that, well, those are red and these have a black plastic insert. But what you do is you have two bearings per wheel, and you would just simply put a bearing on one side. All right. So taking this wheel here for a moment, we would take the wheel, you would have two bearings for it, and you would put the wheel on one, the bearing into one side. You would drop an eccentric spacer in the middle because there's a slight lip there and you don't want the bearings crushing into the plastic. And then you put a bearing on the other side and you push all those in nice and smooth, and that would complete the creation of a wheel like this. So that's the sandwich of a bearing on each side and a washer in the middle, and that's how you assemble these wheels. And you just, they're typically just, you're able to push them in with your fingers. You may need to use a vise or a little pair of pliers just to help to keep it straight if you can't manage it with your fingers. Anyway, so that's the V wheels. Then you also need the eccentric and regular spacer, of course. Now these spacers are a specific thickness, all right? And you have to make sure that the spacers that you're using are the same thickness as your eccentric spacers as well. Now I have a caliper here. If you don't have a pair of calipers, I would suggest that you would get some if you're going to do a lot of 3D modeling for things that you need. And as you can see with this spacer, it is 6.38 millimeters on here, which is 0.2, so a quarter of an inch, all right? 6.35 is probably the actual nominal size of it. The eccentric spacer here, the thickness of the eccentric piece is also 6.37. So it's the same thickness as the spacer. And that is what is really critical, is that these are the same thickness. And you also, in some cases, need to put a precision shim. These shims are basically nominally about 1 millimeter thickness. Yeah, 0.94. This one is measuring on my calipers. And what that does is allow you to increase the spacing between the wheels and the frame. And the reason for that is when you put your nut spacer on here, and you'll see that when we start assembling that, and you put your V-rail in here, that this has got the right amount of spacing for the nut to be able to bolt to here, the Acme thread to run through and not have any bowing on it. All right. Now, when we get to assembling the back plate, there are some other critical things which we will go into there. But for now, let's just continue finishing assembling this particular plate. So the first thing you'll need is some screws, which are, and I'll tell you, I think they're 40 millimeters in size. Yeah, 45 millimeter. I think these ones are slight. I had to cut these ones, so I didn't have any of the exact right size, so I actually cut some. Yeah, these are 45 millimeters in length, and you need the 45 millimeters so that you can actually come through all of these quarter inch and various other thickness spaces and plates with the washers and everything else, and have enough room to put your nuts on the outside without, you know, you want to make sure that your thread is coming out of the nut, because the nuts have nylon bushings in them, which allow them to be shake proof, so they don't unwind themselves while the machine is working. So let's just put this one together. We'll just put the bolt through. And then the next thing you want on this side is a spacer to be put on. Now, for all of these, for the spacing, we do have a precision shim underneath each one. So we'll drop one of those on, and then we drop the wheel. Now, what I'm not doing here is I'm not putting a washer on the top. You can, and if you do put one on, then you need to put a one that is not so big that it is going to impinge on the outside of these wheels. If I just bring this one up closer and show you, all right, you've got this inner part of the bearing, which is what you're going to be clamping, and you know, you want to hold that one firm and tight to the spacer and everything at the back. But this outer one needs to be able to move without impacting anything else that's being statically held. So if you put a small washer on here, like this one, you can see there that it drops on and it's not anywhere close to rubbing on the outside or catching. But if I take one of the bigger washers that I've got here and drop that on, you can see that this one's got a little bit of slop on it, but you can see there that it will and can impinge on the edge. See, it's just about touching it. So you really wouldn't want to use a washer with that is as thick as this, because you could end up binding up the bearing in operation, all right? Because this is not quite either an M5. It's more of a quarter inch washer, or it's a number 20 or something. Anyway, it's an Imperial one. So the ones you want to use are these, if you're going to use any, are the smaller precision shims, because they have no chance of binding, which is also why we use them on the bottom, of course. Now, in this case, the nuts that we're putting on here are also small enough that they're not going to be catching. So unless you really, really need the additional height from here, maybe, and we will when we start to stack them for the double beams that we'll run on them, then you don't necessarily need to put the extra shim on this side, but you do need it on the bottom side. So let me just tighten this up. All right, I just use an Allen wrench, and I have a little socket wrench to make things easier. When you're tightening up the ones with the regular spacers, you can just nip them up fairly tightly, because then there is no adjustment. Although occasionally, because of the tolerances of holes and things like that, you might find that they're not perfectly aligned. So once we start putting them on the rail, I will slacken them off slightly put an even pressure on the top against the rail, so they're all running against the rail, and then tighten them up. That way I'll make sure that they're as much in line as I can. Even though the amount of play is very, very minimal, there is a little bit, and so you can get them where one wheel might be slightly looser than the rest just because of where it sat on the threads and various other things when you put it together. So we will tweak these a little bit once we get it onto a rail. Anyway, let's do the eccentric one now. So the same thing, same length screw, and you can see how sloppy that fits in there. And as I said, that's the reason for that is because the adjustment for the eccentric, so that you can tighten down on the V-rails once everything's in. So this is the eccentric. I've shown you these before, and there's a little notch on one side which indicates where the hole is closest to it. So you want those ultimately, while we start adjusting, to be on the outside, because the extrusion runs on the inside. So this will be the loosest fit until it's on, and then we will be able to get it adjusted once the rail is in. Now, the one thing about these eccentrics too, which is why we have to have the spacers on both sides particularly, is that they do run very close to the outside metalwork of the bearing. So if I try and, let me just put a screw on that a second to show you, because it'd be easier than me trying to keep my fingers in the way. As you can see there, it is very, very close to the outer rim of the bearing. So you really don't want to risk it catching. I don't think it is quite catching, so you potentially could get away without the washer, but really it's not worth the risk, because if it does start binding, it's going to mess up with the accuracy of your CNC and the excessive power being drawn and things like that. So I prefer just to put a washer in behind these ones as well. That's what we're going to do. So let's just put that bolt through, drop on the eccentric, drop a precision shim on top, the wheel on top of that, and then a M5 with plastic insert nut on the top. And just tighten that up. All right, same procedure as before. Put the hex wrench on the back and use the nut on the front to tighten it up. You can use a spanner or whatever you like to tighten the nuts up. I just find a ratcheting wrench far, far easier to use. Once you get it close to being tightened, just take the right size spanner and just rotate the eccentric washer, eccentric spacer, so that the notch is on the outside to maximize how much gap there is, and then you can just gently, you don't want it too tight. You want it just tight enough to hold it in place, but still loose enough that you can adjust the eccentric without too much force. Once we have it adjusted, we will tighten that down just to make sure that there is no more loose looseness in it. And that's pretty much it. So that's the four wheels on now. And if I bring in a piece of extrusion, let me just zoom out a little bit. And I bring in a piece of extrusion so you can see. All right, I have this piece here. And we'll just bring that up. So what happens is this will now just run down. I have the smaller one, of course. Ultimately, it's going to be this piece of extrusion off of the C-axis, but I haven't removed it yet. But I'm just putting it onto here so you can see. So it fits on there fairly easily. There's no real pressure, which is good because all of the eccentrics are outside. Now, if I hold this, you can feel that some of these will turn and actually make it run on the rail. That one there is a little bit tiny looser. And on this side, you can see the same thing. That's going to move the rail if I try and turn it, but that one doesn't. All right, that one does and that one doesn't. So these two are obviously, these two here are obviously slightly closer to the rail than these. Otherwise, these would not be working so well. They wouldn't be as loose. So it's very, very little in it. And I'm sure once I tighten this side up, that slack would probably come out of it anyway. But I do want to just slacken these off, pull them all in by putting some pressure on here. To pull all the wheels this way, and then I'll just nip them up again so that they're all with as even a possible pressure as on the V-rail as I can get before we start moving on to the next step. So I'm just going to do that off camera and we'll come back to you. Okay, just finished adjusting these a little bit. So all I've done is slackened off all four and then maintained an even pressure across the length of this and tightened them back up again. So now when I push tightly against the rail, they're all they're trying to turn. There's a little bit of resistance for each one. Now obviously I haven't adjusted the eccentrics yet, so they're all sitting fairly loose. So if I let go of this, it's just going to drop, and that's fine. I don't want to tighten those up too much until I actually get it onto the x-axis gantry, because if there are any differences in the extrusion, I want to be able to make sure that I account for that. Now I will just tweak it just a little bit, so that it's not just, you know, free rolling here. But that's about all I'm going to do. So all you do with these is, you know, I adjust them so that I'm just, when I turn the wheel, it will move the gantry up and down. So I'm just, if the wheel rotating doesn't do that, then in my mind, it's not quite tight enough. So it doesn't take much. See, that's enough already. That was what, about an eighth of a turn, not even. And it's already now gripping enough that it's going to move it. You can see with this one, that's already doing it. So I'm going to leave that one alone. This one here is not even, you know, there's no friction at all there. So I'm just going to tweak that one in. Now it is. All right. So all three of these now are gripping. As you can see, there's very, very little adjustment. And that last one is not quite touching. So now it is. You see, that was just a tiny amount of adjustment on that wrench. So now that one is slightly loose now because of probably the other pressure from the other one. There we go. So now they're all gripping. Yeah. So they're all doing a fairly good job. They're still fairly loose, but there is no play at all in this. I can't feel any play in any direction as I'm trying to twist this way, and also, you know, rotationally, laterally, etc. And I can't feel any play in that. But I will do a final tweak once we put it on the real rail. These are just ones that I brought in off of the old frame that we were doing. But the X gantry is still in place out in the garage there. So we will tweak it more when we get it onto there. So that's the front of this one done. Now, obviously, we're going to put the real one on in a little bit. So let's go look at the back half of this. So the back plate, as you can see here, is the one that takes the stepper motor on it. And you can also put additional wheels on here too. These four slots are for adjusting the stepper motor tension onto the belt that runs through here. It comes underneath the wheel, up onto the stepper, back down and across. So we may just put some idler wheels in here, or even some additional, you know, solid wheels. I haven't made my mind up yet, but the main thing is that we need four wheels on here. The top two, as you can see, based on the size of these holes, have regular spacers, and the bottom two have eccentric spacers. Now, the thing to remember with this one is it's a double width. You're actually running two lengths like this. These are 60-20s extrusions, and you're running two of them together. So you need a wheel in each of the slots, and you need it close enough that it's going to keep these together like this. You don't want it pushing them apart. See the gap there? You want it so that they're running together. Now they're sitting with a gap there right now just because they're not sitting on my bench fairly evenly. But I'm going to show you what happens now. This is partly to do with the selection of the right spaces and everything. So let me just get this gantry piece put together, and I'll show you the difference using slightly different spacers, and you'll see what's important and what's not important. Okay, first up, what I have here is it's just sitting loose right now. All right, I haven't bolted it all up or anything. I've got a standard quarter spacer to start with. I've then got another quarter spacer on the inside, and I've put a 3mm spacer after that as well. And then the next wheel. Now, if I put this on here, you'll see the minute I push down, you see that gap forming? So if I just leave them loose, they're right together. And as soon as I start putting down some pressure, you'll see that there's that gap, which means that that spacer is too big. I need less gap. It's only not even, you know, it's barely a millimeter gap there. If when I push that together, it's too much. All right, so what am I going to do with that? Let's just take this nut off and we'll remove this 3mm spacer. Now, I've got these washers, which I would like to be able to use. The trouble is they're too wide. Remember what we mentioned before about the risk of rubbing on the inside of the bearings. Well, that's what could happen if you try and use it. All right, it's going to rub. So we're not going to use those. I'd like to, but I can't. So what we have to do is use the precision shims. All right, so I've got one here. Let me just grab another one and put that on, and then we'll put that the quarter inch spacer on there again, and then we'll put the wheel back on, and I'll just put another spacer on the end just so I can hold it together. Now let's do that same experiment that we had here, where we had these together and we just push. I'm pushing these together so the wheels get kept the same. You can see now when I push into this trough, they're not pulling apart. So that very slight adjustment of the spacing there is enough now that I keep these together, and that's exactly what we want. So that's what we're going to have to do, is these little precision spacers. So I'm going to need two. I don't have one on the back here. I need at least 2, 4, 6, 8 of those. All right, because I've got two for the top, two for the eccentric side, two and two. So I'm going to need 8 precision spacers. Now, the other thing that is very critical to remember is if you're planning on putting any screws through here and the heads are on this side, you need to make sure that there is enough clearance, a little bit too much, the gap on this plate, and so anything that's going to go in there needs to have enough clearance so that the head of the screw is not going to impinge on the travel. Now, if I take this other plate here, all right, you can see on this one, I've got two different types of screws. Some are flathead and some have got a little bit of a cone on them. All right, and they're slightly thicker. If you have a close up look, you'll see, if I try and adjust the light, there we go. You can see that they're a bit thicker. So if I put this plate, which is supposed to go on here, all right, I can now see that the head of those screws are actually hitting the aluminum on the inside. So they're going to scrape on the tracks, and we don't want that. That's no good whatsoever. So we need to actually add a little bit of extra spacing. Now, one of the things when assembling this you have to pay attention to is the type of cap heads you've got for your hex nuts. So you can see here I've got three types of M5 screws. The one on the right is a standard M5 machine screw with a curved top on it. The one in the middle is one of Sam's extra thickness from SMB Solutions. So these caps are 2mm thick, but they're flat top. But they are about the same thickness as the one on the right. So the one on the left has a 1mm cap on it. Now the problem is that because they have these hex holes in them for tightening them up, the one on the left is actually susceptible to breaking if you're not careful. You can strip the cap off of it. But the one on the left is the only one that'll go in there without a spacer. So you have two choices. You can choose to use one of these thin ones, which I'm going to use for this specific place. Because right now on this plate, when I'm assembling it, these are the thin ones that you can see here. And these are the 2mm, but the regular dome ones. And if I replace that dome one with the 2mm one, it will still, in fact, let me put one in and show you. If I put a straight edge across the top of the two curved hats, you can see there that it is still touching, even though I've got these bottom two touching. All right. You can see the 1mm one there's got plenty of gap, but that 2mm one is still touching the straight edge. And so I know that without a spacer, that is going to hit the edge of the extrusion. So because on this particular plate, we have 4 mounting holes for these big spacers. I'm just going to go with the thinner ones in this case. If you have, because I don't have enough of these precision shims to hand at the moment, but if you have enough precision shims, then I would suggest you just use the 2mm cap heads, because they're going to be stronger, and put a precision shim in there as well. Anyway, let me just put these in so we can see this thing starting to get assembled. One of the things I'm doing here, which really is a choice of assembly, is I'm putting the flathead screws side of the screws on the front of the X gantry instead of the back. And I'm going to have the nuts on the back of the gantry. This just makes it a little bit easier for assembling and things like that. Just this, it's a preference, that's all on my part. You can equally have the nuts starting from the back, sorry, the screws starting from the back and going through to the front and putting the bolts on the front. And in some cases, that may be easier, because you could probably just simply lay this down flat with a screw sticking up, build the wheel sets up on it, and then lay the front one onto the back. But I mean, if you build it standing up like this too, you can also just simply push it in on the side like that once you're done, and mate it up and then put the bolts on the back. So that's what I'm going to do for this one. All right, so anyway, you've got your eccentric and you've got your regular spacers, your wheels, some more spacers on each wheel. You then have your two precision shims on each wheel. You need to have those for the spacing. And then the last one on here. Okay, now, so you may be asking yourself why, when I had already tested this with the two extrusions, the fit, and I showed you where it was pulling the center apart, why now it is not fitting, whereas before it was. It's probably because once I put the bolt through and actually tightened up the nut, any slack that hadn't yet been taken up in the bearing fit into the wheels, maybe the precision shims weren't perfectly flat when they were just being loose and stuff like that. Once all that had compressed into a nice flat stable state, then it was probably a little narrower than what it was before. So that would account for why now it doesn't fit properly. So the solution is easy now, because we know that these little 3mm shims are the next size up for that. And that's what, these are 1mm shims. So I'm just going to put these 3mm shims in instead of the eccentrics, instead of the precision shims. And we'll make some adjustments with that, and then we'll put it together and we'll try it again. Okay, problem resolved, sort of. It definitely is a 1/4 inch and a 3mm spacer that is required in between each one. Now you can make that up with three precision shims, or if you have some 3mm spacers, then you can use those too. The second issue that I suddenly remembered that I had is that two of my pieces of 60/20 extrusions were actually from a different source than the rest of them, and they have a very, very slight difference in dimensions in the slots. So the reason it was so tight is because the gap in the slot of the V was closer together and tighter, so it was pushing the wheels up higher, which made it much, much more difficult to get them on. I actually just nipped outside to the garage and tried them on my gantry that's out there, which has the correct extrusion on it, and it just slid right on very, very easily. So I know that the spacings and everything else are all set up, no problems at all. So you got to remember that when you're buying your stuff, make sure you get all of your extrusions from the same place. As I say, I got two pieces that I'd gotten from a different source, and they're a slightly tighter fit, and of course that's no good at all. All the other ones that I got from SMB Solutions are fitting just quite happily. But the point here though is that when they're really, really loose, they should just slide on. There may be a there may not be any slop initially, but they should slide on without too much effort. And anyway, I've now figured out why it was, and so lesson learned from me to you is to make sure you get the right extrusions with the right parts and everything else, and from one source, so that you know they're all going to work together. Okie dokie. So that's that part done and dusted. So now we can move on to moving the Z-axis from the old gantry plate onto this one. So you can see when I stand the two gantries side by side, the new red one is slightly higher. Now obviously that's to take into account the extra wheels that are on here. And there's also a little bit of extra height in overall compared to this one as well, as you can see here. And that's basically, as I said, to compensate for adding the extra wheel on the top. What you can't do now on this one, of course, is add an extra front wheel to go onto the extrusion, but that's okay. We've got very wide spaced wheels on the axes anyway, and even the old one only had the four wheels on. I've taken two off because I was using some of the spacers and things on the other gantry, but anyway, we need to take this Z-axis off of here, which means we need to remove the motor mount off the top so we can slide it right off. Unscrew the Acme nut on the back, and we will also remove this and replace it with our new motor mount, which I designed on 3D modeling tools and then 3D printed on my 3D printer. So this is printed with a fill of something like 50% fill factor, which doesn't sound a lot, but I also told it to do 10 wide, I think it was 10 or 8 wide on the perimeters. You can't see it very well on the camera, I don't think. But yeah, maybe there. You can just see how thick I've made the perimeters as well. All of the screw holes, these ones here, they're M5 clearance, so I could put bolts right through if I want to. And also I can put bolts through, this one is designed to go onto a 60 wide piece of extrusion, which is the one I have currently. So we've now got the gantry moved across, as you can see here. Just move up. So this is where the stepper motor will mount on the top. Now I've still got a temporary fitting on here. I have to model a new one, so I'm still going to use the fixture that I was using before, which is basically this with some standoff pipes like these on the top. It's like spaces, 1.5 inches, 2 inches. And then the stepper motor mounted directly on top of that. It's in ABS plastic, and I printed it with 100% fill factor, so it is a very, very strong piece on there. So I'm not too worried about it. And it's very solidly mounted all the way around and tightly screwed down, so I don't think it's going to be going anywhere in a hurry. So anyway, yep, that's basically what we've got now. So if you have a look around here, you can see that we have the new mount. This is the old one that was on there, with the two brackets top and bottom to hold it on, because the holes that were in the back here obviously couldn't be used. And I had to adapt this one. As you can see, I hacked the edges a little bit to clear the screws and things like that. And this was two brackets that I printed. The first one was with a low density fill factor. This top one was a bit more, but I felt that it was too thin on its own to be used for a Boss Colt router or something like that. So I wanted to print a bigger one. So what I did was I printed one solid one, and I also allow for the fact that I could screw it straight through here onto the Z-axis, which means that if I really want to, as you can see here, I can bring it right down to the bottom of the plate. Now, there is no real point in actually bringing it right to the bottom of the plate, because when you mount your router in here, you've got the bottom of the router and everything else until you get to the chuck. And then, you know, there's no point in having the bottom of the router, the cutting edge, never being able to come up and clear this, because this is the highest point on the gantry, is when this is moving across the gantry like this. So when it's, you know, when it's moving like this, if you can't bring your drill bit up to the height of this or just below it, then really that's the limitation on your axis. Whereas, you know, you would have to then, you know, bring this down like this. If you had your this further up, then the beginning of your cutting edge can be in line with the bottom of this plate here, which would be far, far better, you know, by having that. And we'll look at that a bit closer when we come to mount the actual Boss Colt. For now, I've put the six screws in here to mount it to this. So it's, you know, got as many screws in here as it had before. This has been printed on a fine print on my 3D printer, and so now between the four wheels, which you know you can see here, they're all nicely moving on, and they're gripping the axis. You know, each one that I try and move the pair, they're definitely pushing the gantry up and down. So there's no play here that I can feel at all. Trying to twist this around, I can't feel any play. And as you can see, without the stepper motor here, it smoothly moves from one end to the other without any issues. So, and I can't feel any slop in any direction, which is what you want. You want don't want any play in this. And it's just tight enough that it will, you know, use gravity to come down. But of course, the stepper is going to be on the top of here anyway, holding it. Now, the one thing that I do need to be having on here, which this doesn't necessarily, either of these necessarily account for, is on here, you can see I have this bracket on the back of it. Now, there is a hole on this one as well where I can mount that. And the reason I had this mounted is so that my cable chain can screw to something. So when this is moving across the gantry, the cable chain is running off it all nice and neat and bolted to something solid on here. So we do have, you know, we have these holes here, which I use for mounting one of my sensors on this one. So we have that same thing on here. We have the holes here and here. So I can do the same thing by just transferring this bracket across. Now, this doesn't have a hole to get both of these screwed in. So I might just drill an extra hole through here so that I can actually put two bolts through rather than just one, which will make it a little more solid. The sensor for the X axis was bolted through here and I can continue to do that. On the new design that I do for these, I'm gonna make some more robust sensor mounting points and everything for these, so it will be a lot easier and simpler to mount everything. Now, the other thing that I have, which I didn't show you before, on here you can see it quite clearly, is the two screws that are on the backside in the slots. And what these two do is set the Z-axis top and bottom limit. So somehow, before I had a screw mounted in, a bracket mounted into this position. That then had the sensor poking into the back of here so that as this moved up and down, it would be able to sense it. Now, what I'm going to have to do is somehow mount the sensor somewhere so that it's going to be in line with this in here. And I think in a future build, I'm going to extend the height of this front plate so that I can actually put the sensor directly into it right in line with these, which would make life a lot easier. It just means that this would be a little bit taller and it would have an 8 or a 10 millimeter, maybe a 12 millimeter hole in it so that I can push a barrel type proximity sensor in there that would then detect the ferrous metal screws that are in the back here. And these can be adjusted by simply slackening them and moving them up and down to set where you want your limits to be. So it's very simple in operation. It's just a case of having a lack of places to actually mount the screws and things, which is a bit of a problem. But that's not insurmountable. We just have to figure out what it'll do. Now, what I might do for it is actually, I've got a little bit of extra play on here for the on the end of the bolt, as you can see. So what I might do is take this bolt out. It'll hold itself together with all these pieces and actually put a little bracket on here sticking up on the front of here. So take this out, put the bracket on and feed this back through and tighten it down. So I have a bracket up here that I can mount the sensor to. So we'll have to see what I can do with that. Anyway, that's the build of the X gantry. So now the next thing is to start reassembling everything out in the garage. And we'll get back to that. And I'll also show you how I mount the sensor on here. So back out in the garage. It's getting quite cold out now again, so I've got the gantry ready to go back on, all assembled, with a little extra bracket. I was talking about needing to put the sensor on, so that little aluminum bracket you can see on the right hand side there is for mounting the sensor, and I'll show you how that goes in a moment. So first thing, let's get this onto the gantry. So on reassembling the gantry, I've got the X-axis now reinstalled. So it's up here. Haven't put the steppers or anything on yet. But one of the things I wanted to figure out is how to reassemble the cable tray. I had it down here before, low down. And, you know, whilst that worked, I had to drill extra holes and things on the bottom. But one of the things that occurred to me when I'm reassembling it is I can put it up here on this level, which means it's right up where the cables are. And I can reuse the, or dual purpose, the mounting screws that go in to hold the gantry together. So they're all 20 mil apart, and with the third one, which is used for the angle bracket, and I'm using one of these standard right angle brackets, and it fits right on there, right, perfectly. So that's a perfect way to leverage the existing holes and mount the cable tray. So that's what I'm going to do. So we're getting pretty well through putting everything back on. As you can see, I've got the cable tray on this side now remounted up to here where we had that new, where we put the bracket using the holes for the gantry, which works out very well. So that's all nicely done. So that's that side all ready to go. I haven't put the pulley on yet. I'm going to wait till I get the rest done before I do that. And then on the gantry here, you can see where I've put the motor in. And one of the things that I've mentioned is on the bottom is that this bracket, I put it right down at the bottom just for now, but you can see quite clearly that there's no point in having it so far down because I basically eliminate all of this as available headroom should I want it. So, and it won't change anything of the leverage that this can do if it's pushing against the job. So what I want to do is bring this mounting bracket up so that the bottom of the collet here is roughly or just a bit below the bottom of the Z-axis. That way I maximize the amount of space that I have here. And as you can see, I've got about 11 inches, maybe say 10 inches, of headroom from the bottom of the table here. So I'm definitely going to have to build a platform for some of the cutting to minimize any torquing of the head when it's pushing forward or backwards or left to right because of the length that the gantry here is going to, that's not helping you much, is it? Because of the length of the gantry, if it's reaching right down, it's not going to take much, as you can see here, to make it twist. So, except, you know, if I'm doing some light jobs or maybe doing some profiling or something, that would be fine. But if I want to maximize the accuracy, then I want to minimize how much of this Z-axis is sticking down here. Now, when I get the 8040 on here, of course, it's going to be a little better because it's going to be much more robust. The whole frame's here, and here is going to be bigger and stronger. So I'd be able to have more reach without having as much effect. But for now, with this, I need to make sure that this is up, and I'm going to build a platform 4x4 out of MDF to raise it up closer to the job when I'm doing normal pieces of work. And that should be just fine after that. Anyway, the next thing right now is just to lift this up, and I've got to complete putting the sensors back on. Now, what I've done, as I mentioned before, this sensor is exactly where it was mounted before. If I follow the gantry down to this end, you can see here's the screw that I was using for detecting. And if I bring this across, just bring it across right now, I don't have the... Just bring it across. Okay. So right there, so that's good on this side, but I think on the other side, the gantry is actually hitting the rail slightly, so that's okay here. That would actually work out just perfectly, but let's move it to the other side. I've moved across to the other side, and I haven't screwed down this cable tray yet, because that's one of the other things I've got to do, is a bit better mounting at the top here. But if I bring this down to its other limit, you can see I'm actually with the gantry, with this up, it's reaching it and going over with a little bit to spare, like half an inch or something. But if I come around to the front of this, you'll see that where it's hitting that, the edge of these mounting blocks, the motor mount block is now slightly in to this. So if I was lower down and doing some cutting, it would actually hit this. So I really want to bring it in so that it's just hitting the limit at around about that position there. That way I'm not going to be crashing into the Y gantry plates before it hits the limit switch. Okay, so I'm going to tweak that a little bit once we get everything set up. Anyway, for now, I've just got to finish figuring out a bracket. Now, one of the things on the other video I also mentioned was the mounting of the Z-axis sensor, which I've got here. And what I've done is I've just made a little piece of aluminum, looks like about 1/8 of an inch thick, with some adjustable holes on the bottom. And I've used one of the wheel screws to hold it in place, which is quite firm because I made the adjustment for the hole such that it will be parallel to this and touching it, so there's no chance of it moving for, left to right. And then I've removed a little bit of the hardware from the sensor mounting bracket and just screwed the bracket directly onto the top of the plate, and now it provides a very, very good place for the sensor. If I just wind this up by hand a little bit, you'll see, hopefully, the screw just getting in, coming into play there, and it will be tripping that sensor. So that's great. It's better than what it was before. Anyway, I'm going to just make an adjustment bracket for this, and so that I can get this cable tray mounted on up here. And I think that'll be pretty much it, you know, before I start powering back up and starting to tune everything. So anyway, I'll be back. So for mounting the gantry chain plate here, what I've done is I've taken one of my standard angle brackets and I've enlarged the holes on just one end slightly. And what that means now is that it will actually fit with one screw underneath this hook and one right through that hole there, without me having to do any other modifications. I just put a washer on the back of it and that will be good. So I'm just going to get that mounted and then we'll see how we go. So as you can see now, I've got the motor mounted and the chuck bottom is just about in line with the bottom of here. So whatever travel is going to be limited because of this. So that's fine. I mean, if I have to, I can always lower this down a little bit. But one of the things I wanted to point out with the new Rover frame, as you can see quite clearly here, is it ends up quite a height off of the bench compared to the previous one. So probably using a ruler here, this is sitting now 6 inches above the bench to the bottom of this rail, whereas this used to be right on the bench. So I've lost about lost or gained about 6 inches of height there for putting thicker jobs on the workpiece if I ever wanted to do some three-dimensional carving and things. Obviously, if I want to put some Acme screws or ball screws in, then it's going to be quite easy to do so. I can just fit them right here and away we go. Now obviously if I did that though, the steppers would be sticking out here, so I'd have to try and make sure I've still got enough gap to get around the CNC machine, because it'd be sticking out here somewhat. Gantry is all now laid out, all done, and you can see there one of the things that, of course, by having the extra 2.5 inches on this height, my sensor here now is no longer able to pick up on one of these screws being mounted. And of course, the other thing is, with the X plate on here, the screw is also not going to be able to travel past it. So that would be a limitation of having the sensor mounted where it currently is. But anyway, this is the all of the mechanical parts now of the upgrade to the Rover plates and feet and the new Rover frame, and I have to say it is looking pretty cool. Just back up here a bit so you can see it all. Get that mains cable out of the way for the moment. You can see now it just fits underneath the controller over the far end there. I'm going to mount the new controller up on that panel too. I'll take the panel down and take it into the house probably to do that. Anyway, you can see here it just barely fits on my table. Width-wise, it's got plenty of room. Length-wise, it's just coming to the end of the table. I have a slight gap at the end. So this extra size is slightly bigger than the table that I originally built, but it does fit. And what I'm going to do, though, is look at how I can secure this down to the bench, because obviously if it's running, the last thing I want it to happen is any movement or vibration, or if I have any fast acceleration, I don't want the table moving. As you can see here, I can slide it on the table. I would not want that to be happening when it's running. So we really need to have something that would allow the the CNC frame to be tightly and securely mated to the tabletop. So one way of doing that, I'm thinking, is maybe a little bit of section coming down on the end, or using some of the unused screw holes here to just put a bracket down, or some kind of plate that would just secure it down, because I'm not using the Acme screws on here right now. I could reuse these holes for just bolting something down to the tabletop, which would work just fine. The other thing that I'm contemplating doing is, one of the options that you can do with this, of course, is have a table. You can see how my Z-axis will not actually even reach the table. I'm at the limit of my travel right here. You can see it's actually just starting to hit the sensor right there. And even if I dropped my motor mount as far down as it would go, it still would be a few inches off of the tabletop here. So I do have a pile of MDF, which is, I've got cut to 4 feet by 4 feet, which is my workspace size. So I will look at making a box that will bring it up here. Or the other option, which is one of the things that you can do with this frame, is actually to run some extrusions from the back of the frame to the front, mounting them onto these frames here with a bracket, and then having a cross support in the middle as well. You can't go right to the edges because obviously these X-frames would limit you, but you could put something about where the foot is, right across here, and the same on the other side, and then have a support section running in the middle. I'd have to probably draw it up to make it look a bit better, and then actually mount a cutting table right on top of it. So for most things where you're just going to be cutting out sheet goods, your motor can be right up high and close to the gantry, which is going to give you the best accuracy and stability. You know, there's going to be very, very little torquing or anything like that of the motor on the whole mount. I'm just trying to wind this up a little bit so you can see what I mean. If I bring this forward, you can see right now it's going to hit this. But if I have a surface that's above this, as I wind this up, all right, it would reduce my travel as far as that's concerned, and I can compensate for that easy enough. You know, you don't need too much travel. Mostly if you're just doing 3/4 inch, 1 inch, or even 2 inch wood, you can see here, I'm just bringing it up now to almost the top of travel. Another few inches left to go. Anyway, you get the idea. Now that I've done that, you can see there that there's a good few inches of travel available above this frame. So if I did frame something in and then put some MDF on top of it, or some plywood as a surface, I've still got several inches of play. And all I would have to do is remove that surface in order to be able to have a deep breach to some bigger piece of work that I might want to do. Maybe I've got some boxes and I'm, you know, carving something in a lid or something like that. Anyway, I'll draw a few ideas up and share them with you when I post edit this, or maybe in a subsequent video. But for now, that completes the mechanical rebuild for the Rover frames and Rover plates. So we've now got all of the hardware assembled, and I've now got all of the electronics rewired. So I'm just going to give it a quick home test to see if everything is working okay. So let's just give it a try. Let's fire up one of the global controllers with the universal G-code sender, and we'll see if we can just simply send let's see if we can maneuver it and send a home command. That should just work fine. Hopefully I've got the axes set in the right positions now. the Y working. That's X. And that's the Z axis working. And that just tripped it, which I was wanting to test. So that's good. Okay, so now we're ready to try and do a homing test. That's the only thing I'm going to do now before I call this particular one done. So let's do it. Work just fine. Let me see if I can bring it to a zero. Should be fine. And that's the zero that I had programmed earlier when I was doing some testing of the calibration pieces before I did the upgrade to this. So you can see that we're considerably higher now, because that was basically 3/4 of an inch off of the table top, allowing for the thickness of the wood that we had that we were cutting with. Now we're probably about 8 inches higher than that. So this is all to do with these nice new Rover legs and the 2.5 inch taller Rover Y plates. So yeah, got a little bit of work to build a platform, or to build a, well, either way, building a platform, either out of wood or use some of the extrusions that I've got to build something that's going to go across the gantry this direction, and then across the middle, so that I can lay a platform of wood on top of it for when I'm doing some just basic sheet work. Anyway, that's everything done, so let's call this quits, and I'll get to some other testing now.